or long term requirement of the company. Okay. Is my am I clearly audible now? I think so. Students, am I clearly audible now? Please kindly confirm. Yes, yes, fine. Thank you so much. So, as we're discussing about this particular topic about the requirement of the finance in the company, there maybe you could say two basic requirements. That would be short term, which is for less than 1 year period of time, or the requirement of the finances for long range, that is called the long term loans, or any other, you could say, long term venture which the company is looking after. And for that particular period, the company will actually look after for the arrangement of finances for a period ranging from 1 to 5 years. Okay. Now, on keeping in consideration all these requirements of the company, basically we have major sources of finances, or how the company can actually arrange the finances. Okay. So first of all, we'll discuss about the bifurcation of this particular finances part. Okay. Now, the first bifurcation which we have, that is about the according to period, or the dividation of the source of finance on the basis of period. I mean, the time period we are talking right now, it may be according to ownership. The third one, it would be from the sources of generation. Sources of generation. Okay. The fifth, or the, you could say, the third category is the source of generation. And the fifth basically is the part of this category now. Now we will discuss only these three major categories of sources of finances. The first is period, second is ownership, and third is sources of generation. Okay. Now you can see that the first point we are discussing right now, that is according to period. Okay. So that we'll discuss now, that is according to period, or you could say according to the range of, you could say, years, which is required in the company, how the particular finances or source of finances can be divided. Okay. So the first and foremost thing which we'll discuss right now about the short term source of finances, and then we'll move to the long term sources of finances after that. So the major bifurcation we'll discuss right now. Okay. So first one, that is about the according to period. Now, as I told you, according to period means that maybe you could say long term sources or maybe short term sources. Okay. So long term sources, and second, maybe short term sources. Now, what are the major, you could say, options available for the company when it comes to long term sources? That maybe you could say shares. The second may be your debentures. We'll discuss in detail all these points. Okay. Then we have long term loans, which is ranging from 1 to 5 years, or any other, you could say, share capital with the company want to earn. So definitely these topics which you're talking right now about the shares, about the debentures, about the loans, we'll discuss all these topics in detail about type of shares, type of debentures, type of loans, which we have in the long term sources of finances. Now, when we come to short term sources of finances, when we come to short-term sources of finances, we have basically the options related to commercial banks, first of all. That is, you can take the short-term loan from the banks. That is called the commercial banks, from where you can take the loan up to 1 year period of time. You can go for some deposits that may be called your public deposits, I think so. Okay. The third category, which we have, creditors, from where you can arrange the fund and you can purchase the items on credit basis. And after a period of time, you can, you could say, repay the amount to the creditors. And the last one, any advances from the customer. Advances from customer, or you could say the advance amount received by the company from the customer. So make sure these are the two major bifurcation about the long-term and short-term source of finances, which may ranging from up to 1 year is short-term, and more than 1 year, it would be long-term sources of finances. Okay. The second bifurcation we have, that is about the according to ownership. Okay. Make sure this is the last lecture we are discussing right now for theory topic, because from tomorrow onwards, we have all about numericals. Okay. The next one, we have long-term sources of finance. The second category is called your according to ownership. Okay. Now, as I told you in the last class as well, the ownership basis of finances may be of two types. It may be owned capital or it may be borrowed capital as well. Okay. It may be either owned capital or it may be borrowed capital as well. Okay. So the first category which we have, owned capital, and second is the borrowed capital. You can also call it as internal capital, or you may say that external capital as well. Okay. Now, when we discuss about this particular first part, that is called the owned capital. So owned capital includes what are different options that we have: the options of share capital, that the owner can invest the money in the particular organization. We have retained earning. I think we discussed in the last class about what is retained earning. Okay. Along with that, we have some surpluses if it is in the company, etc. Okay. The second category, which comes under category of ownership bifurcation, that is called the borrowed capital. Borrowed capital is basically nothing but external capital for the company. Now, these external capital may be arranged in terms of debentures. You can say debt capital. Again, we can say that public deposits. And we can say the next one is the loans, etc. There are two major bifurcation on the basis of ownership of the funds. Okay. The third category and the last category under the source of finances, we have according to sources of generation. According to sources of generation. Okay. Now, how we can generate the sources, as I told you already, there may be, you could say, internal sources, or it may be external sources. Okay. As I discussed already, internal sources may be in terms of retained earning. We discuss the example right now. It may be your share capital, or it may be surpluses, and borrowed capital may be the part of your external earning. Okay. I hope so. These three bifurcation are the major heads of sources of finances. Yes. Am I clear with this, please? Yes, I think there was some issue with this Google Meet right now when it's come to my video. I might be it get resolved soon and my video will be on. Okay. No, I think my screen is visible, Miss Sonia. Is my screen visible? I think so. No. Is my screen visible, students? The source of finances, according to period, according to ownership, according to source of generation. No, Neelam, my mic is not off actually. Yes, Jolly, thank you so much. Neelam, please kindly check at your part. Might be some technical issues at your end. You can rejoin the class, I think so. Far better. Okay. No, I'm just talking. I'm just sharing my screen now. Actually, I was just looking forward for that screen. Is my screen visible now? I think so. According to source of generation. Yes, student, is it clear now? I think, is it visible? My screen is visible now. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, fine. Thank you so much. Please kindly check at your end because I'm just sharing my screen right now. Might be video is somehow just facing some problem right now with the video connection. Okay. It might be resolved very soon. Okay. So I'm moving to the next topic right now. That is the major sources of your short-term sources of finances. Okay. So I'm moving to the next topic, that is called your short-term sources of finances. Okay. Now in this particular topic, we will discuss, first of all, that is trade credit. The second one we will discuss, that is called your bank finances. Third, we will discuss about commercial paper. Fourth, we'll discuss about accrued expenses and deferred income. Okay. So these four major heads, which we'll cover up under short-term sources of finances. Okay. Now, the first category of short-term source of finances, that will be the part of your trade credit. The second category of short-term source of finances, it would be your bank finances. I think if you remember in the last class, we discussed about the procurement of funds and we were discussing about the major heads comes under source of finances. Now, today we are discussing in detail about what are the major sources we have. Okay. The third category would be your commercial paper and the fourth would be your accrued expenses and deferred income. These are the four major topics which we'll cover up under short-term source of finances. Let's start with the first one. That is called the trade credit. Okay. When we discuss about the very simple and very important topic in case of short-term source of finances, the first category is called your trade credit. Now, when we discuss about what is trade credit, first of all, trade credit means any type of facility which is provided by the supplier in order to purchase the goods on credit basis. Now, in this particular process, the company or the customer need not to pay the amount to the company on immediate basis. For example, if I'm purchasing goods from a company on 2nd of February, that is of 1 lakh rupees, and the company has actually given me a facility to pay that amount after 1 month, after 15 days, or whatever period of time which they have decided. So any type of, you could say, credit facility given by the supplier to all their customers, it would be the part of your trade credit. Okay. So it is nothing but credit extended by supplier. Credit extended by supplier of goods and services. Of goods and services. Okay. Now, important thing in this particular case, always remember that whenever we talk about any trade credit part, this trade credit is basically an informal agreement. Okay. This is an informal agreement in terms of that the agreement between the two parties may be on the grounds of, you could say, goodwill basis. Okay. So always remember when we did always basically an informal agreement between the two parties or between the customer and the company. Okay. Between the buyer and the seller, which we can say as well. Okay. Now, there are basically different type of trade credits we have. Okay. So basically the types of trade credits we have. Type of trade credits. The number one, which called your open account or open credit. We'll discuss all this point one by one. The first one is called your open credit. Or we may say the open account. You might heard this particular topic very first time. The second point is called your pro note, or it is also called promissory note. The third category of trade credit is called your bills payable. Okay. So we'll discuss all these points one by one. Okay. I think it is clear to everyone what is trade credit. Any credit facility given by supplier to its customer. Is it clear, please, everyone? Kindly confirm.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So let's start with the very first point. What is open credit system or what is open account? Okay. Always remember when we discuss about this particular open system or open credit system, this is again basically an informal agreement between the supplier and the customer in order to prepare the books of account for that customer. For example, if I'm talking about this particular open credit system, means the account of the customer in the books of the company. I'm repeating once again, the accounts or account of the customer in the book of company. That is called the open credit or open account. I think if you remember, these particular customers are basically considered as a debtors in the organization. Okay. So usually if we can say that these individuals or these customers would be considered as a current assets of the company and these are called the daters in the organization. Okay, is it clear, please? And always make sure whenever a particular supplier is giving any credit facility to their customer, in such a case, it is important that these credit facility will be always given by on the basis of the credibility or credit worthiness of the customer. Okay, is it clear what is open account? Yes, student, is it clear, please? What is open account?
Yes, sir.
Yes, perfect. The second point is called your pro note, or it is also called promissory note. Now, the pro note is opposite to the open account. It is basically a formal agreement, a legal agreement between the buyer and the seller. In case if any type of disputes you have, or any type of, you could say, the problems arises in terms of your agreements, that definitely there would be some legal action may be taken against the supplier or against the customer in case of any default, or in case of any mismatches, or in case of any, you could say, problem arises when it's come to transaction, or when it's come to deal between the two parties. So always remember, the promissory note, it's a formal agreement between the buyer and the seller. And this is basically the part of acknowledgement as well. Always remember, if the particular buyer fails to make the payment on the maturity date, it may be possible that the supplier may charge some penalties, may charge some interest on non-payment on the due date. Okay, so always remember, the promissory note is basically a formal agreement, and it is basically, we can say that it is an acknowledgement as well. It is always as an acknowledgement which is given by the buyer to the seller in order to fulfill the promise which is being mentioned in the legal agreement. Okay, is it clear, please? Yes, student, is it clear, please, everyone?
Yes, sir.
The next part which we have is called the bills payable. Now, bills payable is again basically a legal documentation of the legal instrument which is being prepared by the seller. Let me type this. The legal instrument prepared by seller and accepted by buyer for payment on due date. Okay. So this is again nothing but the opposite of that. Now make sure the promissory note or the bills payable, what is the difference in this particular two part that we need to understand? Okay. Now when we discuss about this particular promissory note, definitely in the case of promissory note, there may be a possibility that you may charge some penalty or interest, but usually the bills payable is a legal instrumentation. If there is any non-payment we have, there may be, you could say, some legal actions against that particular person. There is not having much differences, we can say, but bills payable is, you could say, it is more authentic as compared to promissory note. Is it clear, please, everyone?
Okay, sir.
Okay.
So is bill payable equal to the cash momo that we get after purchasing of any product?
No, please kind of repeat your question.
So that bills payable, is it same as of the cash momo or the like the bill that we get after purchase of any product?
No. Actually, bills payable is basically drawn against a bank. Okay. For example, like if being a company, if I'm issuing a bill in the favor of, let us suppose, for example, your name is
Sonia, sir.
Yeah, Sonia. Okay. So if like you are purchasing some goods from my side, and if I'm just issuing a particular, you could say, a bill in the favor of you, and definitely you are accepting that bill, and by stating that the amount will be paid to the company in the concerned bank on this particular due date.
Okay, sir. Okay.
It is different to cash memo, because cash memo is basically the real time settlement between the buyer and the seller.
Yeah, after the payment of the money.
Yes, definitely. So it is nothing but the acknowledgement which we are providing to the customer, or the legal documentation we are providing to the customer, just to assure that there is a transition between the two parties.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Now the next part which we need to discuss right now, that is what are the various credit terms we have under this particular bills trade credit. Okay. Now when I'm just talking about this particular trade credit, okay, just try to understand first of all the credit terms. Okay, I think you might know about what is trade discount and what is cash discount. You know about this? What is trade and cash discount? Yes, any one of you? Trade discount and cash discount. Student, any one of you?
Sir, can I say?
Yeah, yeah, please, please, continue.
Sir, trade.
I think Sonia, you are not audible.
Oh, sir, basically trade discount is the discount that manufacturer is giving to the reseller. That is the trade discount, sir. For him to so that he could buy it and sell it to other person, the manufacturer is giving some kind of discount. That is known as trade discount, sir.
Okay. Like anyone else? Yes, continue, please, Rajula, I think. Okay, please try to understand what is trade discount and what is cash discount first of all. Then we'll move to the credit terms. Okay. When we talk about this particular TD and CD, that is trade discount and cash discount. Okay. Because when we talk about the trade discount, any discount which is given in order to promote your sales. Okay. Always remember TD I'm talking right now. Any discount which is given to promote your sales. Discount given to promote sales of the company. Okay. Now always make sure, like for example, if I have to purchase 100 units of any item, okay, and the company is giving me an offer that if you will purchase 10 more units, I will give you 10% discount on that. Okay. So whenever any discount which is given by the company on the quantity, okay, on the number of units, it is called your trade discount. And always remember, trade discount will not be recorded. Okay. It won't be recorded in the books of accounts. Why it is not recorded? Because this discount is basically the net amount which the company is basically reflecting. For example, if I have to purchase 100 units of a good and that costing 1 lakh rupees. Okay. If the company is giving me an offer that if you'll purchase 10 more units, I will give you 10% discount on that. So definitely the amount which the company is liable to pay is only the discounted amount. Okay. And this discount is just given by the company just to promote the sales, just to increase the number of units to be sold to the customer. That is called your trade discount. Okay. The second is called your CD. That is called cash discount. Cash discount is always given by the company to their customer for prior payment of debts before due date. Like for example, if there are certain, you could say, debtors you have, and from those debtors, the amount is due to receive on, let's suppose, 15th of February. Okay. But you want to recover that amount before 10th Feb or before 5th Feb. So what you will do, you will give an offer to your debtors that if you will pay the amount before 10th February, I will give you 10% of discount on that. Okay. Make sure always any discount given by the company to their customer for prompt payment or for the prior payment before due date, in such a cases, it is basically expenses for the company. Okay. But that fund is being utilized by the company in some other avenues. Okay. So always remember, this cash discount is just nothing but any discount given by the company to the debtors in order to recover the amount due to receive from the debtors before due date. That is called your cash discount. Okay. Now the credit term, which is an important topic over here in the case of trade credit, that credit terms are basically nothing but the conditions, or you could say the option given by the seller to the buyer in case if the buyer is ready to give the discount, ready to, you could say, make the payment before due date. Now try to understand what are the different terminology, how which we use actually. For example, let's suppose 3 by 15, comma, net 45. Okay, because always remember, whenever we talk about any, you could say, bills or any trade credit note or any documentation, these type of terminology you always see over there. Okay, that is 3 by 15 net 45. Now, what is the meaning of this particular part? Okay, the meaning of this particular part is that the due date is 45 days. I'll just check it to you. The due date is 45 days from the date of transaction, 45 days. But if buyer will make the payment, if the buyer will make the payment before 15th day, means at least by till 30th day, okay, if buyer the make the payment on or before the company is give 3% discount on the total bill amount. 3% discount is being given by the company. So this is basically the one of the important trade credit terms which always you can see on any trade credit or any credit note. Okay, so 3 by 15 net 45 means if you will make the payment within 15 days, you will get 3% discount. Else you will make the payment till in 45 days. I hope so. This credit term is also clear.
Yes, sir.
Everyone?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. So we'll move to the second part now, that is called the bank finances. Okay. I hope so. We are going with the right speed right now, because I'm not going a bit fast. It's the very first week of this subject, and this subject is very technical. Again, I'm telling you. So we'll go a bit slow because it's a practical subject. And I'm just creating the base right now for this particular subject. Okay. Now we'll discuss about the bank finances. Now, when we talk about this bank finances, means any type of credit facility provided by any bank. These banks may be private bank, commercial bank, cooperative banks, or any type of bank belong in this particular geographical region or territory. Okay. Now, when we discuss about this particular bank finances, we have actually major 5 types of bank finances. Okay. Can anyone name it out, please? The first is the cash credit, which is called CC limit. And the person belongs to business class, definitely they know about it. Second one is called your overdraft. The third one is called your discounting of bill. The fourth category is your letter of credit. And the fifth category is your working capital loan. Okay, so the major, you could say, 5 part we'll discuss in this particular class about this bank finances. Okay, so when we discuss about this particular 5 major categories of bank finances, the first part will move now, that is the cash credit. Okay, anyone having any idea what is cash credit?
Sir, cash credit is the some deposit of the bank, then bank give some money.
Okay. Fine. So what is the basic purpose behind providing cash credit? How the cash credit can be given?
So basically, in case of cash credit, person who needs a credit, it's one kind of like a loan. The customer needs credit on basis of a particular amount. After taking this credit from a bank, they need to pay, the customer need to pay the interest after a certain time of period. So it's a process of cash credit. It's a one kind of loan system.
Yes, definitely. First of all, it is one type of working capital loan. It is type of working capital loan. Okay, so always remember when we discuss about the cash credit. And one more thing, always remember that cash credit facility is always given to the business class or always given to the business, you could say, people. Okay, cash credit will always be given against some collateral as well. Okay, so always remember, first of all, what is cash credit? It is basically type of working capital loan or working capital credit, and these particular cash credit is given against a collateral, or you could say issued against a collateral. Okay, this collateral may be any stock statement issued against any collateral. These collateral may be, you could say, the stock statement of the company. Okay, now in this particular, always remember, whatever, for example, I'll just give you an example that would be far better. For example, if I'm running a manufacturing company right now, and in the manufacturing company, basically I have certain stock available, stock in terms of raw material, finished goods, or WIP, it may be. Okay, what we do, basically, we always audit our firm at the end of the financial year. Okay, in this particular case, the CA always prepared your stock statement. Like, for example, your stock statement is of values of 5 lakh rupees, for example, I'm taking right now. So what the bank will do, against those 5 lakh rupees of stock available in the company, the bank will actually issue a certain, you could say, credit facility or loan facility against that collateral. That collateral basically called your stock statement. Okay, always remember one more thing. Whatever limit, for example, bank has given you 4 lakh rupees of cash credit, so bank will charge interest on that particular withdrawal limit. Charge interest on withdrawal amount. Is it clear, please? Yes, students. Is it clear, please? I think there is some query to the anyone. Everyone, please, is it clear? What is cash credit?
Yes, sir.
Yes. One more thing which I want to update you regarding this, because always remember, whenever we talk about any cash credit facility, these cash credit facility and the legal procedure or the legal, you could say, methodology, the RBI always actually amend, always RBI always actually keep a keen watch about the margin limit as well. Okay, now what is margin actually in the case of cash credit? Okay, so always remember, the guidelines in terms of issuing or the margin which is required, for example, as I told you, that 5 lakh rupees of this stock statement. So what the bank can give, bank can actually issue up to 3 lakh, 3.5 lakh. Means they always keep a margin between the total value of the stock and total loan or CC loan which is given to the corporate or any organization. That is called the margin understanding. Okay. Is it clear, please? Required margin? Is the margin concept clear, please?
Yes, sir.
Yes, fine. Now, second option of your bank finances, it is the overdraft facility. It is called OD. Overdraft facility. Okay. Now, what is the difference between first? Because both overdraft and CC are type of working capital loan. Okay. CC is given against the stock statement, or we may say against the inventory statement or any account receivables of the company. Okay. What about overdraft? Any idea to anyone? Yes, students. Any idea to anyone? What is overdraft facility? For example, let us suppose if I have certain receivables, okay, in terms of, you could say, bills receivables, some shares and securities are available with me, or we may say certain FDs, fixed deposits which I have, or certain, you could say, government deposits which I have. What the you could say organization do, because definitely all those fixed deposits, or we talk about any government deposits or any other, you could say, financial security, these securities are always for long term in nature. Okay. So what the company do, or what the, you could say, business class always do, they always actually take the loan on all Poonam, please kindly mute yourself. Yes. So whenever you could say any type of credit facility, any credit facility given by bank on financial instruments or financial securities, we can say, I think better word would be any type of, you could say, credit facility, it is given by the bank on financial security, that would be the part of your overdraft. Okay, again, the mechanism of this particular mechanism of this particular overdraft would be similar to the cash credit, but always remember that cash credit is basically given on the stock statement of the company, but overdraft facility is given by on the financial security of the organization. Yes, when is it clear, please? Yes, when is it clear? Anyone? Any doubt in this, please? Overdraft? Yes, students, please kindly confirm. Now, security options would be what? That may be your shares, we may say. Okay. That may be your fixed deposits. I hope so, I'm audible, students. Yes. So it may be, you could say, yes, any type of, you could say, shares. It may be any type of, you could say, fixed deposits. Okay. Any type of, you could say, government bonds. Okay. Or you could say, yes, I think so. We will cover up in this. Okay, any type of place documentation. Okay, that is not needed right now. It is quite sufficient. So any shares, any FDs, any government bonds, any other security which is in the form of debt bonds, or you could say debt securities, that would be the basic, you could say, security which is always backed up when it's come to overdraft loan facilities. Clear? Let's move to the next part, please. The third category of your bank finances, which is called your bills of discounting, or you could say purchasing of bills. Okay. Okay, discounting of bills. Now, just let me explain you with the help of example. I think so. That would be far better. What is bills of discount, or what is discounting of bills? Okay. Now, as you know that the company always provide the credit facility to their customers. Okay. But if the company want to actually convert their all, you could say, securities, or you could say all such receivables, which you might receive after 1 month, after 2 months, after 3 months, the period may vary from transactions. Okay. Discounting of bills, basically a facility which is provided by any bank to their concerned customer. In such a case, what the company do, they actually submit their receivables to the bank. They submit their receivable to the bank. And what the bank do, bank definitely immediately discount their bill. For example, if I have a transaction with one of the customer, Sonia, okay, and Sonia has actually purchased the goods of 1 lakh rupees from my side. Okay, now Sonia has promised me to pay the amount after 1 month period of time. But if the company want to encash, company want to convert those receivables immediately in the form of cash, so what I will do, I submit those bills to the bank. What the bank will do, bank will charge certain commission, certain fee on that, and immediately return around 90%, 95%, 80% of the total bill amount. Okay, this is a very basically a facility which is provided by the banks to their customer in terms of converting their, you could say, receivables or their debts, which may be, you could say, generated after due date. But if you want to convert those in the form of cash immediately, you may approach to this procedure of discounting of bills. Am I clear with this?
Yes, sir.
Because see, these topics are, because there are so many topics we have which might require some description, some you could say some statement and some discussion, all such topic, because everything we cannot cover up in theoretical aspects. So discounting of bill is clear, please, everyone? Shall we move to the next part then? That is letter of credit, LC. Yes, students, shall we move to the next part, please? LC, letter of credit.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Now, what is letter of credit? Okay. Letter of credit is again basically a facility which is given by the bank to their customers. Now, what type of facility that we need to understand? Okay. Letter of credit basically is a guarantee which is given by the bank to any customer or to any, you could say, third party. For example, I'll take an example directly. I think that would be far better. For example, like there is a basically a buyer and the seller. Okay. Now, if the buyer want to purchase some item from the seller, let's suppose the value of that particular transaction is 10 lakh rupees. Okay. Now, how the seller can actually assure that the buyer is credit worthy or the buyer will make the payment on the due date or buyer will basically clear the amount or buyer will clear the payments. Always remember, the bank always take the guarantee on the behalf of the buyer that the buyer will make the payment on the future date. So basically, letter of credit basically is a facility which is provided by the bank to the buyer that assures to the seller that the amount will be paid by the buyer on the due date. In case, if the buyer fails to make the payment on the due date, definitely bank will be liable to make the payment which is due to receive from the buyer. For this particular arrangement, for this particular facility, bank always charge some commission, bank always charge some fee from the concerned customer. So it is nothing but a guarantee. You could say an assurance from the customer side, and that will be taken on the behalf of the customer from the bank. That is called letter of credit. I think if you remember, the case of Nirav Modi, okay, the LC which is issued by Punjab National Bank, and that LC is being presented in the foreign and they took the loan, and that LC was actually a fraud. So that is basically the LC is all about. You can read on the internet basically what is LC in that particular scam in India. Is it clear, please?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. The last part which comes under this category is called your working capital loan. Okay. Now, what is working capital loan? Working capital loan is any, I think, again, one example of working capital loan fraud, if you remember about Anil Ambani. Okay. There was a case of Anil Ambani. You just read on the internet about what was the actual issue with Anil Ambani with the bank. I think if you remember, Mukesh Ambani actually supported him in terms of there was a case from again the Supreme Court as well. Okay. So the things which were actually settled down between the bank and the customer, that was actually issue of working capital loan, which was taken by Anil Ambani from the bank. Okay. Now, what is working capital loan that we need to understand? Working capital loan is basically any type of credit facility in order to meet your short-term liabilities, in order to meet your short-term obligations in terms of any payments, in terms of any expenses, in terms of, you could say, any contingencies if it arises in the business. Okay. So always remember, any type of, you could say, short-term loan facility provided by the company to their, customer in order to meet their unforeseen contingency or unexpected contingencies.
So like of Sahara scam?
I think Sahara is not working capital loan actually. Okay, Sahara case is basically the long-term loan which they have taken and there was some issue regarding repayment of the loans.
Yes, sir.
But if you read the case of Anil Ambani, that is the case of working capital loan actually. And LC is the case of Nirav Modi.
Nirav Modi. Okay, sir. Okay.
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 Clear? Is the working capital loan clear, please, everyone? We have discussed this bank finances now. CC, OD, discounting of bills, LC, and working capital loans. Yes, am I clear, please? Kindly confirm?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So let's move to the next topic now. That is the third category. I think if you remember, we are discussing this part, okay? We are done with trade credit, we are done with bank finances. Now we are moving to the third category, that is called your, let me just name it out, I think the second one. And third we are discussing right now, that is called your commercial papers. Yes, the next part is called your commercial paper. Now basically, what is commercial paper? Commercial paper, first of all, it is money market instrument. Anyone who can tell me what is money market instrument or capital market instrument? Anyone, what is money market instrument?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. So try to understand what is money market instrument or what is money market first of all. Basically, there are two types of financial market in India or throughout the world, if you can say, there are basically two types of market. First is capital market, second is money market. Okay, money market is basically any type of securities in terms of commercial paper, in terms of, you could say, call money, notice money, certificate of deposits, money market, mutual funds, means any type of securities issued by the company to their customer for less than 1 year period of time. And these securities are basically sold out or basically provided by the company to their customer over OTC, over the counter. Okay. So any security, yes, please.
IPO, sir, like of IPO.
IPO is capital market. That is through exchange only. Anything through exchange is capital market securities.
Okay, sir.
And anything which is through OTC means over the counter or through the through any banking channel or through any brokers, agents, that is called money market instruments.
Okay, sir.
Because the major instrument which come under this money market instrument is called basically call money. Because I'm not going to discuss in detail right now. Notice money, CD, certificate deposits, commercial paper, CP, triple MF, money market mutual funds. Repo instrumentation, you can read it please after this class, you can just go through with this topics because it's not a part of a syllabus right now, but I'm just still giving you a brief about what is money market instrumentation. So this certificate of deposits, basically, commercial paper is type of money market instrument. Okay. And these basically money market instrument are those instrument which is issued by the company over OTC, over the counter. Okay. And for less than 1 year period of time. Okay. Now what is commercial paper which we need to understand? Commercial paper basically it is a debt security which is issued by the company in order to raise the fund from the public. Any type of, you could say, debt security which is issued by the company to their customer or to the, you could say, investors. And on those particular, you could say, security or debt instrumentation, the company will basically pay an interest. It is similar like a debt instrumentation. For example, if I purchase commercial paper of any XYZ company of 1 lakh rupees and company is liable to pay 10% interest on that. Okay. So this is basically the commercial paper. Any type of, you could say, short-term money market instrumentation issued by the company to their investor with the help of bank or any other, you could say, partner, channel partner or any banking partner. And these particular, you could say, commercial paper are a debt securities, and these debt securities are basically having short-term maturity. As I told you already that the securities tenure should be less than 1 year period of time and company is liable to pay interest on it. Is it clear, please? It is short-term pro note or promissory note, we can say. It is unsecured in nature because it is majorly issued by the corporates, that is about the private organizations. Okay. Any doubt, please? An interest is basically always paid on its face value or you could say the value of your security. Is it clear, please, everyone? Because I'm not going into detail right now about what is CP, the RBI terminology for CP, who the companies also are eligible for CP, because in order to issue a CP for the investor, definitely you need to fulfill certain guidelines of RBI, because everyone cannot issue CP or CD or any money market instrumentation. You need to follow the guidelines of the RBI, and if you you could say fit to that, you could say pro forma, definitely you would be liable to, or not liable, you would be you could say having an option to issue such securities for your customers. Hanji, is it clear, please?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. Now, the last category of your short-term finances we are going for, that is your accrued expenses. I think those who are from accounts, they might know about this. Accrued expenses, deferred incomes. Hanji, anyone? What is accrued expenses? Any idea?
No idea, sir.
Okay. See, always remember, when we talk about the accrued expenses, any type of expenses in the form of liability that you need to pay, okay, that you need to pay after the, you could say, what we can say the term actually, after that particular service is being rendered. Okay. Now, like for example, like let's suppose the company is basically pay their wages, company pays their salaries, company pay, you could say, taxes, company pay, you could say, interest. Okay, so always remember, the accrued expenses, or you could say accrued facility, is all such facilities. What the company do, basically company, rather to pay those particular amount immediately to the concerned users, they actually generate those liabilities, and they actually settle those liability once the fund is available in the company. That is called accrued expense. For example, for your employees, the salary of 4 months is due. Okay. And this is accrued expense. Why it is accrued expenses? Because company is liable to pay that particular expenses definitely on the future date. Okay. So any type of, you could say, facility on which you can hold the expense of the company, and you can make the payment once the sufficient amount of fund is available in the organization. I hope so it is clear. What is accrued expenses?
Yes, sir.
It's an interest fee finances as well. Because for example, if you have to pay salary to your 30 workers, okay, for example, the amount is 20 lakh rupees. Okay, that 20 lakh, if you're seeing for 6 months, sorry, 3 months, you have 60 lakh rupees in your hand, and without interest as well. Okay, are you getting my point? I think so. What is accrued expenses? Okay, that is basically a liability that firm has to pay for the services it has already received. Because services of your you could say employees or your workers, you have already received, but the amount for the same is not paid yet. Okay, so any type of, you could say, facility. It, and again, make sure, it is the most important part, is basically it is instantaneous arrangement of fund without any interest. Okay, so it is basically interest free source of finance. I hope so. Am I clear with this, please?
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir.
Perfect. The next one, we will move to the deferred income. Okay. Now, what is deferred? Deferred means basically delayed. Okay. Someone is joining the class. Okay. So deferred is basically the delayed one. Okay. So for example, I'll just give an example first of all, and then I'll explain you what is DI is all about. Okay. Now, when we discuss about this deferred income is basically any type of, you could say, funds received by the company in advance against the goods and services which will be delivered by the company on the future date. Okay, what happened basically, like for example, if I'm supposed to deliver the goods to Sonia after 6 month period of time, okay, and Sonia has made the payment to me on 3rd February itself of 5 lakh rupees, but I have received the amount in advance, but the services and the goods which I have to deliver to Sonia, it is after 6 months. So any, you could say, income, any amount or any fund which you have received in advance from your customer, and these basically you could say advances always increase the liquidity or the fund arrangement of the company. So this is again the one of the sources from where the company may have some advance income in the organization. So it is fund received by the company in advance or advance against goods or services to be delivered in future. Am I clear, please? DI and AE, accrued expenses and deferred income. Yes, I hope so. We are going with the right pace right now. You are getting each and every topic very, very clearly.
Yes, sir.
Perfect.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So any query till this moment, please?
No, sir.
Okay, so shall we move to the next topic, please? I think I'm taking only 1 minute of break. Will it be okay? I think so.
Yes, sir. No problem.
Yeah, sure. Yes, shall we resume now, I think? Okay. So second category of finances, which we need to discuss now, that is called long-term finances. I think someone has raised the hand. Abdul Hamid. Any doubt you have, Abdul? You raised your hand, actually. No, I hope so. Okay, fine. So let's move to the next category and the important one again, the second bifurcation of your source of finances. That is called long-term sources of finance. Okay. Now, in this particular category, we will discuss three major heads. Okay. The first one is financing through capital market, which I'll discuss with you now. What is capital market is all about. The second one is through financial institutions, that is banks and any other commercial organizations. The third category is any dynamic or innovative forms of finances. I think you remember, I think we discussed venture capitalist, seed financing, okay? That are the basic example of this innovative forms of financing. Okay, that we'll discuss now one by one. Okay, so let's start with the first topic right now, that is financing through capital market. What is capital market? First of all, as I told you already, money market and capital market. Capital market is basically the you could say a place where the company can arrange the fund for long-term basis. Okay, so always remember, under capital market, the company can actually arrange the fund on the long-term basis, and the two major you could say head which comes under capital market of source of finances, that would be called your debentures and shareholding or share capital. Okay, so share capital and second would be your debentures. These are the two major, you could say, source of finances which we will discuss under this particular topic. Okay. Shall we start, please? One is retained earning term loans. Okay, fine. So we'll start with this particular first part that is called your share capital. Okay. Now, so let's start with the first part right now, that is share capital. Okay. Always remember the you could say the long-term source of finance, the major source through which the company can raise the fund for the organization is the share capital. Now, first of all, we need to understand what is share capital. Share capital is nothing but basically the dividing the ownership on the basis of number of units, dividing the ownership on the basis of number of small units. And the basic purpose behind this share capital, that in order to make the share purchasing or share procurement, you could say, more accessible for the investors, the share capital concept basically is being provided by the, you could say, government or the financial institutions. Okay. So first of all, what is share capital, which we need to understand? That is dividing number of, or dividing into number of small, number of small individual units, and each unit is called share. Share means a part of ownership, which you always actually generate, which you always actually take from the organization. Okay. Now, basically, this share capital is of two types. That is equity share capital, and second is called your preference share capital. Okay. So share capital, which we'll discuss right now in this particular category, that is called your equity share capital. And second one is called your preference share capital. Okay. So we'll start with the first part right now. I think, is it clear, everyone, what is share capital?
Yes.
Perfect. Now, first part is your equity share. Now, what is equity? Equity means the main owner, the core owner of the company. Okay. Always remember, equity share capital or equity shareholders are basically those investors, or those, you could say, shareholders, those who are actually taking the ownership rights, decision-making rights, voting rights in terms of company's policy-making, in terms of company's decision-making. Okay. So this is basically the source of core ownership. Source of core ownership. Always remember, these particularly equity shareholders, equity shareholders, there is no assurance of the dividend declaration. Okay, so always remember, there won't be no promise of dividend declaration at the end of the accounting year. Okay, because they are the core owner, the first priority is always given to the debt securities, then preference share, and the last one we have equity share. Because I think in the further topic, we'll discuss about the income statement. At the time, I'll tell you what the sequence of, you could say, disbursement of the profit sharing among different stakeholders. Okay. Always remember, the important thing which comes under this equity share capital, they have the rights to vote, rights to participate, and right to actually interfere in the company's, you could say, any activities or any proceedings. Okay. The second important thing is in this particular category that they have a differential right in terms of the voting, or differential right in terms of dividend, or differential right in terms of any other, you could say, legal proceedings of the company. Okay. So always remember, the equity shareholder basically having the right to vote, right to participate, right to dividend as well. But this dividend is not being promised, because the equity shareholder are the last resort when it's come to dividing the profit from the company's part. Okay. Now, when we talk about this particular share capital, okay, these share capital are basically the basically of three types. Okay, so let's start with this part right now. One more thing which I want to mention over here, they are the legal owner of the company. Okay. Now I'm going to start with the type of shares or type of share capital. Okay. The first category of share capital, it is called your authorized share capital. I'll give you an example as well. You will be able to understand very, very easily. Authorized share capital. Second is issued share capital. The third one is called your subscribed and paid up share capital. Okay. So when we discuss about the very first part about the authorized share capital, student always remember, like whenever any company can issue up to an extent of share capital from the market, for example, if the RBI has given the permission, if you have the legal permission to raise the capital from the public, definitely there are some maximum limit of share capital or of the, you could say, fund which you can generate from the public. Okay, so maximum amount of share capital which can be raised by the company, maximum amount of share capital which can be raised by the company. Clear, please? Yes, student, is it clear? The maximum amount of share capital. For example, the RBI has given you permission to raise 50 lakh rupees. So up to 50 lakh, you can raise the fund in the form of share capital from the market. Is it clear, please? Kindly confirm.
What
is
operating?
The second category, which is called your, like one more thing, I think just for your knowledge purpose, I'm just telling you. When we discuss about this authorized share capital, always remember this maximum limit may be altered as well. Okay, just for knowledge purpose, I'm telling you right now, this maximum limit may be altered. The important thing is that this alteration or these changes are only possible when you will change your MOA, Memorandum of Association. Okay, the alteration is possible in the changes of your alteration in maximum limit. Is possible by changing MOA. I think you know about what is MOA, Memorandum of Association, Article of Association. Okay, MOA basically nothing but a legal documentation in which all the duties, responsibilities, and the core values, and the legal rights, and the legal aspect is being mentioned when the company forms. Okay, so by that particular purpose, you can actually change the authorized share capital by changing or by altering your MOA. Am I clear, please?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. Now, second is issued share capital. Issued share capital. Issued share capital, basically the capital which is being issued to the public. For example, you have a limit to raise the capital of 50 lakh rupees. Okay. But the company has actually issued only 20 lakh or 25 lakh or 30 lakh rupees. So that 30 lakh rupees of shares issued by the company, or you could 30 lakh of, you could say, ownership share or share equity share issued by the company to the, investors. So that issued one issued by the company to the shareholders, it is called your issued share capital. So always remember, issued to public, or you can say investor, these capital will be called your issued share capital. Hanji, is it clear, please?
Yes, sir.
Hanji, Next one, it is about your subscribed and paid up. 1 minute, please. Now, what is subscribed? You could say capital. Subscribed capital, again, please try to focus on my words. Subscribed capital is basically part of issued capital. I'm repeating once again. Subscribed capital is basically the part of issued capital which is being accepted by the shareholders. Which is being accepted by the shareholders. For example, you have issued 30 lakh rupees of share with the example which I'm quoting you right now. But the shareholder receive only 27 lakh rupees. But 27 is subscribed. Subscribed means actually being received, actually being confirmed by the public or by the investors. Okay. So subscribe, always remember, please. Part of issued capital. Part of issued capital accepted by shareholders. Accepted by shareholders. Am I clear, please? What is subscribed right now?
Yes, sir.
Now, the next one is paid up share capital. Okay. Usually, in a general sense, I'm talking right now, subscribed share capital and paid up share capital is almost similar. Okay. The only difference is that the paid up share capital is basically those share capital. Like, for example, the example of 27, you remember 30, 50 was the maximum amount, 50 lakh, 30 issued to the public, 27 accepted by the public. Now, accepted and amount received, again, different thing. For example, 27 lakh amount, it is being accepted by the shareholders. Okay, but the amount which is being received is only 25 lakh. But usually it is not a scenario in the market nowadays. Whatever being subscribed or whatever being accepted by the shareholders, definitely they will invest their money into the company. Okay, so always remember, subscribed and paid up is almost similar. But sometimes what happens, if certain shareholder is unable to make the payment on time or on the due date, in such a cases, there may be a difference between subscribed and the paid up capital. Okay, so part of subscribed capital paid up by shareholders. I hope so. Am I clear with this? 50, 30, 27, 25. Is there like we can understand this particular topic? I hope so, students. Am I clear with this, please?
Yes, sir.
Authorized issue. If you can do one thing as well, you can just pick any balance sheet of any company. Okay. Or you just see the example on Google. You can search it out, please. You can see the examples actually on live grounds, actually, how this capital is being reflected into the accounting statement of any organization. Am I clear, please?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. Okay, so we can take, I think, one more topic for the day, because this topic will be covered up completely by tomorrow only, because we have discussed the type of preference shares we have, debentures we have, and then we have retained earnings, and then we have bank loans. So a lot of topics are still left in this, because it's a very lengthy topic. Leasing, hire purchase, okay, venture capital, seed financing, a lot of things are there in this particular unit. Okay, so after that, we will discuss about the next category of share capital. Okay, that is called your preference share capital, and that will cover up in today's class. Okay, shall we start, please? If it is clear,
yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Perfect. Because see, this particular topic of equity share is very lengthy. Because if I need to cover up about the RBI guidelines, if I need to cover about the buyback of equity shares, the various conditions, the various guidelines, there are n number of things which we can discuss, but we are just sticking to the time along with sticking to the components of number of lectures in which we need to cover the syllabus as well. Okay, so the next topic which I'm going to cover up right now is called your preference shares. This is the last topic for the day as well. Okay, preference shares. Always remember, the basic difference between preference share and the equity share is the preference shareholder having the privilege to receive the dividend before equity shares. One more thing, that preference shareholder do not have any right of voting, do not have any right to interfere in the company's, you could say, policy making or company's decision making. Okay, so always remember, this preference share are usually not the core owner of the company, first of all. Okay, they are basically all those investors or all those shareholders, those who are actually looking forward to invest their money in the company just to earn or just to receive the dividend on the preferable ground over the equity shareholders. Okay, one more thing always remember, the preference shareholders may be the, you could say, the hybrid form of share capital, because preference share may be converted into equity as well. Okay, so always remember, the preference shareholders may be in the form of hybrid shareholders or hybrid share capital. Okay, in this case, it may be possibility that this preference share may get converted into equity shares on the later stages of the company's operational activities. Okay. The first thing or the main characteristics of the preference shareholders is basically right to claim dividends, because they have a preferential rights, or you could say priority rights, over the equity shareholders to receive or to claim dividends from the company. Okay. And in case if they want to, you could say, withdraw their money from the company as well, they again have a preferential right over the claim of repayment of their capital or repayment of their amount invested. Okay, so let me just give you a quick brief about this particular preference share. The first and foremost thing is all about this preference share, that they are the preferential claim over dividends. Okay, the first thing, preferential claims over dividend, the first and foremost thing. And this is usually the hybrid form of financing. Hybrid form means the combination of debt and equity. Hybrid form of financing. And the major, you could say, the characteristics is that they have a right to claim dividends. Right to claim dividends. And the second right which they always possess, that is right to claim repayment of capital as well, if it is needed. Because they don't have that much legal foundation in terms of claiming the rights as well. Is it clear, everyone, please? Preference shareholders?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. So we'll discuss the types of preference shares now. The last topic of the day. Then we'll continue from debentures in tomorrow's class. Preference share capital. Okay. Type of preference shares. Okay. I'll just name it out first and then we'll discuss one by one. Okay. The first preference share type is basically called your cumulative preference shares. The second one is called your non-cumulative. The third one is participating. The fourth one is non-participating. The fifth one is redeemable. Sixth one is non-redeemable. Seventh one is convertible. And the last one is non-convertible. Okay. So one by one we'll discuss. It's very short. It's a simple topic actually. Now, when we come to cumulative preference share, what is the meaning of cumulation, please? Anyone from statistics? Yes?
No, sir. Anybody? Increasing or increased in quantity, degree or force?
Okay. Anyone, please? What is cumulative preference shares? Or what is the meaning of cumulatives? No? Okay, listen. For example, let's suppose if I have invested in one of the company and I have purchased 100 shares of 1,000 rupees. Okay. So your total investment, if you talk about, like, for example, 100 shares, if you have invested of 1,000 rupees. So total investment would be your 1 lakh. Okay. On these 1 lakh rupees, definitely you are generating some interest or dividend, we can say, on yearly basis. Rather to collect those dividend on yearly basis, you are actually accumulating it. Accumulating means you are adding into the principals. For example, 1 lakh and dividend is 20,000. So next year, your principal amount or your opening amount would be 1 lakh 20. Next year, again, you receive the dividend of 30,000. So it would be 120 plus 30. And at the end of second year, it would be 1 lakh 50,000. Are you getting my point? So any type of, you could say, dividend, which is being not received by the investors on yearly basis, but it would be paid at the end or at the time when this particular preference share would get redeemed, or it would actually having an expiry or due date to receive the amount. Okay, so not to receive the dividend on you could say frequent basis, but you are actually accumulating it. Clear, please? I think. Yes. Second is non-cumulative, means when you will talk about this particular dividend, when you are receiving the dividend on periodic basis. Receiving dividend on periodic basis. Periodic means monthly, not monthly usually. Basically, it's yearly or half yearly, you are receiving the dividends. Okay. And cumulative, basically, it is accumulation. Accumulation until fully paid. Fully paid means on due date. Okay. Next one is participating preference shares. Participating preference shares are basically those, you could say, preference shares in which the shareholder have a right to interfere, right to give their suggestions, right to give their, you could say, words in front of the management. It is called the participating preference shares. Okay. In this case, always remember, the participating preference shares always having the right to fix their dividend as well. Okay, for example, if they are expecting a dividend of 10%, so they have a right to fix their dividend percentage as well. Okay, so always remember, the participating preference shares is basically the category of preference shares in which you have a right to fix the dividend every year. Right to fix their dividend every year. So these type of preference shareholder are called your participating preferences.
Sir, Indian Oil does that.
Yes, definitely. Usually, most of the, you could say, big brands or big giant companies, if you talk about, they issue such, you could say, preferential, because they do not have any issues when it's come to a flow of finances.
So they usually include the union leader. They are all, that is also, that can be also a participating preference share, sir.
Yes, for example, if the particular category of investor are expecting a dividend of 10%, 20%, whatsoever, if the company is basically giving the consent on the same, definitely they may be categorized as a participating.
Okay, sir.
Okay. And non-participating is opposite of that. Okay. Means fixed rate of dividend every year. Okay. So fixed rate of dividend every year. That is called non-participating. Clear?
Okay, sir.
Anji. The next one is redeemable. Redeemable means which can be, which any preference share which having the due date, for example, 5 years or 10 years. So any preference share which would be redeemed after a due date, it would be called your redeemable preference shares. Means any share which having the expiry date. Okay. Irredeemable, we do not have any expiry. irredeemable, we do not have any expiry date until unless any contingencies or any winding up of the company situation does not arise. Okay? Redeemable, irredeemable is clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Convertible. 1 minute. Convertible. Okay? Convertible means those preference share which can be converted from preference share to equity shares. Okay? These shares are called your convertible equity shares. And non-convertible, any equity share, sorry, any preference share which will never convert in the form of equity throughout its span of time or throughout the existence of that share is called your non-convertible preference shares. Am I clear, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's all for the day, please. Okay. That is sufficient, I think so. And tomorrow we'll continue from debentures and type of debenture and other topics to be completed. Any query to anyone, please, from the session, please let me know. I hope so. I tried my level best to give the basic understanding about all these finances.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Kaushik.
Sir, मैं बोल रहा था सर जो क्लास का वीडियो है इसको क्या मिलेगा हमको?
I think who's there, Kaushik?
क्लास का जो वीडियो है सर अभी जो आपने जो क्लास किया उसका टोटल
इसके रिगार्डिंग एक बार आप लोग एडमिन डिपार्टमेंट से बात कीजिएगा रुचि मैम से वो आपको इसमें हेल्प करेंगे
सर दूसरा कि मैं ये बोल रही थी कि क्या आप ये लेक्चर का टाइम चेंज कर सकते हो प्लीज
क्या टाइम रख सकते हैं हम लोग
सर मॉर्निंग में
नो नो मॉर्निंग एक्चुअली आई हैव सम अदर असाइनमेंट्स एक्चुअली So like we can keep it from 5 to 7 or 6 to 8. Any time is I think more suitable because all of you are most probably the working individuals.
Yes, sir.
Sir, the timing 4 to 6 ho sakti hai.
Pardon, please.
Sir, timing sir, jo hai, sir, 4 to 6 ho sakti hai.
Wo bhi manage nahi ho payega.
Actually,